Jussie Smollett should come clear. The truth will set him free.
I've known him for 8 years. I've never known him to lie.
This turns out to be a modern day lie, if the police are right.
Taxpayers funded this investigation. They can't just not give us the information.
That'll be totally up to the new attorney general.
I don't think there's anything Trump could be looking forward to here.
This is New Day with Allison Camerota and John Berman.
All right, welcome to our viewers in the United States and all around the world. This is New Day. It's Thursday, February 21st, 6 o'clock here in New York, and we have a ton of breaking news this morning. In just hours, a bail hearing is set for Empire actor Jussie Smollett. He's now facing a felony charge for allegedly filing a false police report claiming that two men attacked him last month. Also, a chilling case in Maryland. A Coast Guard officer is accused of planning a mass murder. The lieutenant, whom authorities say is a domestic terrorist and a self-proclaimed white nationalist, is set to appear in court today. Officials say his targets include Democratic lawmakers and journalists. A court filing revealed that he'd been stockpiling weapons in his apartment just outside Washington, D.C.
Okay, and there's a lot more news. There's a big development in Robert Mueller's investigation. Sources tell CNN the report could be handed over to Attorney General Bill Barr as early as next week. The filing of this highly anticipated report may ignite new controversy over how much of it Congress and the American public gets to see. So we have so much to cover for you this morning. Let's begin with CNN's Ryan Young. He is live in Chicago for us with the latest twist in the Jussie Smollett case. Ryan.
Yeah, Allison, as of an hour ago, the actor still hasn't turned himself in. Look, this story is gaining national attention and people wondering how it will come to an end. Jussie Smollett going from an alleged victim to a suspect in a possible felony, with Chicago police saying that the Empire actor filed a false police report when he claimed these two men attacked him last month while hurling racist and homophobic slurs.
I don't have any doubt in my mind that that's them. Never did.
Authorities say the brothers testified before a grand jury on Wednesday for 2.5 hours. Their lawyers telling reporters that the men were paid by Smollett to carry out the attack.
There was a point where this story needed to be told, and they manned up and they said, you know what, we're going to correct this.
One police source telling CNN investigators are working to obtain Smollett's financial records to corroborate the claim. This surveillance video shows the two men inside a beauty supply store just one day before the alleged attack, purchasing items including a ski mask and a red hat. One source telling CNN Smollett missed a scheduled meeting with police on Wednesday. His attorney saying in a statement Wednesday night, like any other citizen, Mr. Smollett enjoys the presumption of innocence. Authorities tweeting Wednesday that they're looking to speak with Smollett's lawyers to negotiate a reasonable surrender for his arrest.
And Allison, we've been talking to our sources overnight to try to figure out, do they know the whereabouts of the actor? That so far has come back with, they don't know where he is. They want to see if he's going to walk himself in or if his lawyers are going to call police to try to figure out how they're going to play this out. Allison?
Oh, boy, these next few hours will be very interesting to see how that unfolds. Ryan, thank you. Here to give us more info is CNN legal analyst Joey Jackson. He's a criminal defense attorney. Joey. So Jussie Smollett now faces charges of felony disorderly conduct for filing a false police report. What does that mean for him? And does that charge come with jail time?
What it means is that he's in a very bad place. And now, obviously, everybody gets the presumption of innocence and will determine later exactly what happened. But as it's looking now, Allison, it looks problematic. You cannot file a false police report to the issue of jail time. It's a felony. That felony carries 1 to 3 years. And notwithstanding, you know, in this particular case, I think there's an incentive for jail because you want to set the example that this is not the proper thing to do. Again, we don't know, and it'll be determined through the course of the judicial process exactly what occurred, but there's a real deterrent factor. You're diverting resources, and people cannot be doing this if it's not true. And so, therefore, I think his exposure is significant.
There's new evidence that has come to light, and it's this video of the two brothers who are no longer called suspects, and it's them purchasing things, the hat, they're purchasing ski masks, they're purchasing sunglasses. But explain to me how this video, which looks incriminating to them, somehow implicates Jussie Smollett.
Well, it implicates him very specifically. Remember now, we have a narrative from these two brothers. These two brothers, Allison, are saying that, listen, this is what went down. They're cooperating with the police. We were paid, allegedly, to do this. We set this up. We practiced beforehand. We purchased a rope. We purchased a mask. We purchased other items. And it's not only my word. This is when I was in the store. The police pulled the records, including that surveillance tape. That's what we call evidence. That's also what we call corroboration.
But I mean, it's his word against their words, and he's sticking to his story that they attacked him. So what do police do next?
In every trial, in every situation, not that we're there yet, there's going to be conflicting evidence. You're going to have person A say one thing, person B say another. Therefore, it's left to common sense. People are going to ask themselves, if it goes this far, do these facts seem likely? 2 o'clock in the morning, you are approached. At that particular time, why were you there? Why was your manager on the phone? Why did you delay 40 minutes to speak to the police? Why did you redact your phone records? And so obviously, when instances where there's no smoking gun, and I would assert that that is a smoking gun, you used corroborating, supportive, circumstantial evidence to prove your case.
We've got 2 seconds. What if Jussie Smollett doesn't turn himself in this morning?
Then the police go get him. Look, he has to obey judicial process, and a surrender is much more likely to be favorable to him on the issue of bail. Bail is to ensure your return to court. In the event he surrenders, it shows he's not a flight risk. That would be a good look.
George Jackson, thank you.
Thank you
very much, John.
All right, a Coast Guard lieutenant and a self-described white nationalist is due to appear in court today. Federal prosecutors call him a domestic terrorist who stockpiled a big cache of weapons and was planning a mass killing with several political and media figures on his hit list. Our Jessica Snyder live in Washington with the very latest here. Jessica.
Yeah, John, and this man prosecutors say was planning mass murder was at the same time going to work every day at Coast Guard headquarters here in Washington, D.C. Now, when the Coast Guard eventually noticed red flags, they launched an investigation, and agents discovered an arsenal in the suspect's apartment.
Court documents providing chilling details about a Coast Guard lieutenant who prosecutors say hoped to murder innocent civilians on a scale rarely seen in this country before being arrested in Maryland last week. 49-year-old Christopher Hassan is facing federal charges of illegal possession of a firearm and possession of a controlled substance. But prosecutors say these charges are just the tip of the iceberg, writing, "The defendant is a domestic terrorist bent on committing acts dangerous to human life that are intended to affect government conduct." Investigators say they found this hit list on Hassan's computer containing names of prominent Democrats, including House Speaker Nancy Pelosi, Senate Minority Leader Chuck Schumer, and Representative Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, as well as a number of 2020 Democratic candidates, including Senators Kamala Harris, Cory Booker, and Kirsten Gillibrand. The list also containing the names of several journalists from CNN and MSNBC. Federal agents say they found 15 firearms and more than 1,000 rounds of ammunition in Hassan's Maryland apartment, in addition to a stockpile of steroids the government says Hassan was using to increase his ability to conduct attacks. In emails outlined in court filings, Hassan calls himself a white nationalist and was inspired by a manifesto written by Anders Breivik, a Norwegian terrorist convicted of killing 77 people in 2011. Prosecutors say roughly a month before his arrest, Hassan Googled topics including, "Are Supreme Court justices protected? Where do most senators live in D.C.? And civil war if Trump impeached."
And Lieutenant Hassan will be in court this afternoon in Maryland for a detention hearing. Prosecutors are pushing the judge to keep him behind bars because of the major threat they say he poses. John?
All right, Jessica Snyder for us in Washington. I want to bring in Lisa Monaco, the former assistant to the president for Homeland Security and Counterterrorism under President Obama. And Lisa, you're also a career federal prosecutor. I want to read you the first line of this detention memo. It says, "The defendant intends to murder innocent civilians on a scale rarely seen in this country. He must be detained pending trial." That is chilling. Lisa, what does it tell you?
Well, good morning, John. It is stunning. That first line of that detention memo really took my breath away. As you mentioned, I was a career federal prosecutor. I also oversaw all terrorism and national security prosecutions nationwide when I was in the Justice Department. And I have never seen a detention memo start with a sentence like that. So that was really stunning.
And we put up the target list. We know that this man had been looking into media figures, Democratic political figures. We also know that he had been reading the manifesto from a European terrorist, that 1,500-page manifesto from Anders Breivik. What does that tell you?
Well, that the Breivik focus is really interesting to me. You know, the Breivik incident happened and his attacks happened. 77 people killed in Norway happened in 2011. And so that was when I was in the Justice Department and I was very focused on that case. But it is not a household name when it comes to terrorism cases. So it says to me that this Hassan guys is pretty committed, pretty focused, and he was following this manifesto almost to a T in a very tactical sense.
Very tactical sense. He was stockpiling performance-enhancing drugs because Breivik suggested that and diet somehow put you in a better frame of mind to carry out terror attacks. The environment in this country right now, some people consider a toxic environment. How do you think that will play into this case?
Well, we're going to have to see how this case unfolds, John, but there's no doubt that this arrest and this detention that the government is seeking today in the hearing is in line with a rise that we've seen in domestic extremism and hate crimes over time. In 2017, we saw a threefold increase by some measures in far-right extremist attacks. So this is consistent with those trends and really quite concerning to folks who focus on domestic terrorism.
And very quickly, we still don't know exactly how this came to light, how this crossed the transom of law enforcement. Why is that important to you?
That is one of the big questions I have. You know, how did this guy come on law enforcement's radar? Did he, was there a tip? Was there somebody at work who saw something strange? Was he under surveillance for some other reasons? Well, it looks like he was buying drugs from individuals outside of this country. Were those people under surveillance? So all of those things are big questions.
Lisa Monaco, thank you very much for being with us. We're going to stay on this case.
Thanks.
Okay, John, our next big story, Michael Cohen will testify in public next week before the House Oversight Committee. The president's longtime lawyer, now a convicted felon, canceled an earlier appearance citing safety concerns. A judge has now granted Cohen a 2-month delay to surrender for his 3-year prison term. Ryan Nobles is live on Capitol Hill with the latest. Ryan.
That's right, Allison. This on-again, off-again, highly anticipated hearing is now back on again. It will happen next Wednesday, February 27th, and it will happen here on Capitol Hill while the president is on the other side of the world meeting with Kim Jong-un in that second summit with the North Korean leader. Of course, the president's former lawyer canceling that first appearance because he was worried about safety concerns, and now we are getting a sense of exactly what he will tell congressional leaders in this open hearing. Elijah Cummings, the chair of the House Oversight Committee, saying this in a statement yesterday, that the scope of the hearing will address the president's payoffs, financial disclosures, compliance with campaign finance laws, business practices, and other matters. And of course, there is some concern about the way that the president and the White House have handled Cohen's public appearances. The mayor's or the president's lawyer, Rudy Giuliani, bringing up Cohen's father-in-law in repeated press statements. And Nancy Pelosi's made it very clear that they are not going to tolerate any threats to Michael Cohen. In a tweet yesterday, she said, Michael Cohen will come in front of the Oversight Dem and House Intel Committees next week. Congress has an independent duty under the Constitution to conduct oversight of the executive branch, and any efforts to intimidate family members or pressure witnesses will not be tolerated. Cohen himself tweeting that he is looking forward to telling his side of the story. Of course, Allison, he is scheduled to report to prison at the beginning of May. Allison.
Ryan, thank you very much for setting all of that up. Joining us now to talk about it is John Avlon. He's our CNN senior political analyst. So Ryan just laid out what they want to talk to him about, all the financial disclosures. Here's what Elijah Cummings, the chairman, says they don't want to talk to him about. The scope of the Oversight Committee's open public hearing will not include questions relating to the Intelligence Committee's investigation of efforts by Russia to influence the 2016 election and other matters. What do you see here and what's going to happen?
Look, that's a clear, bright line, but the headline here is the revelations will finally be televised. This has been delayed several times. Under intimidation of his father, he said. And it's significant because he has knowledge not only of the campaign, and you saw Elijah Cummings' note, but also of the business practices. So this is going to be a wide-ranging and, I think, pretty revelatory testimony.
I wonder what makes us think he's going to show up next week since he canceled. I mean, everybody thought he was going to show up for February 7th until he canceled it, and he says under threat of intimidation from Rudy Giuliani, the president's attorney, and the president.
Well, in part because he's confronted those. The House said, House Dems say they won't permit it. It's understandable to have a little bit of Lucy in the football about this.
Yeah.
But he is committed to this date, and the judge has extended his time before he has to report to prison in part because so he had time to prepare for this testimony.
It's also interesting that he himself tweeted that I look forward to telling the American people my story, hashtag truth.
Hashtag truth. This is the rehabilitation of Michael Cohen's reputation. He seems to be taking it very seriously, and he's in a unique position to know as Donald Trump's longtime fixer. He was there in the room.
I mean, the fact that the judge has postponed him having to report to prison from March 6th to now May 6th, you know, I just wonder if he thinks that maybe he's going to somehow dodge it altogether, or if he thinks that he can postpone it indefinitely.
I think that game doesn't work even for, you know, white-collar criminals. It's a serious charge. Most folks wouldn't get time off for shoulder surgery.
So yeah, but would most people get time off for cooperating like he is, for publicly testifying to everything he knows?
And that's one of the weird things that Cohen didn't try to make a deal, as far as we know. Cohen really seems to be trying simply to come clean. This almost is a period of confessing your sins in public, because he feels he was basically played for a patsy by the most powerful man in the world.
What are you looking forward to hearing from Michael Cohen? What still needs to be answered?
I think the key questions are the things that only Michael Cohen could know. Someone who was at Donald Trump's side, who in some ways was Donald Trump's mini-me, in business with some shady practice, in the campaign with payoffs allegedly to these paramours and more. What was his relation with Russia, not with regard to the investigation, but with regard to his businesses? Cohen could be in a unique position to know and tell.
And, of course, who directed him to make those payments?
That's one of the key questions.
John Avalon, thank you.
Thanks, Alex.
John.
All right, Allison. Sources tell CNN the attorney general is preparing to announce as early as next week the completion of Robert Mueller's Russia investigation. But exactly how much of that report will lawmakers and the public see? We have new details on how this process will work from one of the reporters who broke the story. That's next. Sources tell CNN that Attorney General William Barr is preparing to announce the completion of Robert Mueller's Russia investigation as early as next week. But how much of this confidential report will Congress and the public ever get to see? Joining us now to discuss, Laura Jarrett, CNN Justice reporter, who broke this story, Asha Rangappa, a former FBI special agent, and Joe Lockhart, former Clinton White House press secretary. Laura, I want to start with you here. First, terrific reporting on this. What were some of the signs that you and your team saw that made this evident? And number two, how is this going to work next week insofar as we know?
So as to the signs, a big shout out has to go to our amazing stakeout team, who is out in front of the special counsel's office literally every single day, rain and snow. And they saw last week that in an unusual move, they were carting out boxes from the office, something that they hadn't seen before. They had also noticed a number of attorneys from Maine Justice and the D.C. U.S. Attorney's Office coming over. They'd also noticed that the grand jury, which we've also been watching day in and day out, hasn't been there, hasn't been spotted at the courthouse since January 24th, the day that they returned the indictment on Roger Stone, Trump's longtime advisor. So we were piecing together all of these clues for a long time, asking our sources every day, when is this happening? What's going on? And what we finally pieced together yesterday is that the current plan, understanding it could change, because the fact is the justice officials are very mindful of the fact that the president is supposed to go overseas next week. He's supposed to have the summit with North Korea. And so they want to be mindful of those diplomatic efforts. But the current plan is for, in the next week, Robert Mueller to deliver his confidential report to the Attorney General, Bill Barr. Bill Barr will then say, public, I have received it, I'm reviewing it. And then sometime soon thereafter, in the next couple weeks, possibly 10 days, he will submit his own executive summary to Congress. And the big question is, what exactly is he going to say to Congress?
And therein lies the rub, Asha, because, I mean, how unsatisfying will it be if Bill Barr just gives some sort of cursory summary or some sort of headline? And in fact, Senator Richard Blumenthal wanted to know what it was that Bill Barr would be able to provide. And so he asked him about this on January 15th. Watch this.
Will you commit that you will explain to us any changes or deletions that you make to the special counsel report that's submitted to you in whatever you present to us?
I will commit to providing as much information as I can consistent with the regulations.
He'll commit to being noncommittal. I mean, what does that mean? What will the public learn?
Yeah, so, you know, he is there referring to the internal regulations of the Department of Justice, which is not to reveal derogatory information on individuals that are not charged. And if you think back to James Comey, this is partly what he was criticized for, is for going on and saying, we're not charging Hillary, but she was reckless and all this kind of stuff, because it then kind of casts a pall on people who may not have committed, you know, criminal acts. The issue here, though, is that this is a case of intense national interest and public importance, because it's not just an investigation like with the Clintons about his private sexual behavior. This is about interference in an election and how it affected the American people. So I think that those privacy interests or some of those regulations have to be balanced against his obligation or Congress's need to know what actually took place in this investigation.
There's also a glitch in the system here, which is that Justice Department regulations are that a president can't be charged or can't be indicted. Also, William Barr is saying, well, we don't reveal any of the details on declinations when we decline to prosecute. Well, they can't prosecute. Yes. Does that mean they're not going to release any of the details? Joe, you think that might be politically impossible?
I do think it's politically impossible. This is just too important, as Asha said, and you got the catch-22 perfectly, which is, if your policy is you can't indict someone, then, and your policy is also you can't release any information about someone you're not going to indict, then you're going to bury this. I just don't think you can bury this. And I think if they do bury it, that will be an impetus for the Democrats to open impeachment hearings, because impeachment hearings are not about, you don't start an impeachment hearing by saying, we're going to impeach. You start it as a fact-gathering process. And I really do think that'll leave them no choice and a huge pretext for saying, this is why we have to do this.
Laura, here's the latest public opinion poll, for what it's worth. This is a CNN poll that shows there's great interest from the American public. That 87% of the American public have been, you know, waiting to find out what Robert Mueller discovers. And again, it would just be really anticlimactic if this comes out. And I understand, I mean, I think that Asha makes a great point that it could be redacted and you don't want to hear derogatory things about people who aren't somehow central. But we have to hear the conclusion.
Yeah, I'd like to know who that 9% is and what their thinking is on that. I mean, I think Asha and Joe are absolutely right. The political aspect here for Barr is really dangerous. I don't see how he's at least not going to be facing a huge subpoena from Congress right away. They're going to try to haul Robert Mueller up to the Hill right away to press him on exactly what he said in that report. Whether he'll answer, whether he'll come voluntarily, whether the Justice Department will try to block it, I think all of this is going to get litigated to the highest levels, probably up to the Supreme Court. I think we're going to now be in the next tranche of this. We've been in the investigative tranche for a long time, and I think the next step here is the congressional fights and all of the battles on Capitol Hill. But the regulations, I mean, they just give him so much authority. And I think it's part of the reason that you see even Republicans like Senator Chuck Grassley coming together in a bipartisan fashion with Senator Coons to say, wait a minute, the regulations here actually don't say that he's supposed to give everything to Congress. The regulations say all he has to do is only reveal if there were times where the Justice Department told Mueller that's a step too far. So anything where he wasn't allowed to proceed with an investigative step, they do have to reveal that. They do have to tell Congress when he's done, of course. But other than that, the regulations just don't provide for it, especially not the sort of the underpinnings, the factual evidence, all of the things that people are going to want to see that backs up all the findings in the report. That's certainly not provided for in the regulations as they're written right now.
All right, we have some new video just into CNN that I think is worth seeing in the spirit of video that we've broken here on New Day.
This one's different.
Regarding
this has
Roger
a different
Stone.
Tone, I feel.
This is Roger Stone in Florida getting ready.
Okay, thank you.
I'm going to leave you hanging there for a second.
Yeah.
I want you to hear Roger Stone.
He said, right. Enjoy the weather.
He's in Florida enjoying the weather. He's headed to Washington, D.C. for a hearing before the judge, Amy Berman Jackson. This is the judge whom he put up in an Instagram post. He is being hauled in there for a hearing, perhaps to consider whether to further enforce the gag order or maybe, Asha, revoke his bail. How much trouble is he in today? What's going to happen?
Well, he is in trouble. I mean, you don't post a picture of a federal judge in crosshairs and not have, you know, U.S. Marshals show up at your house and you know, give you a warning and end up in court. But I think that this is going to be a stern warning. I would be surprised if she revoked his bail because, you know, she has to strike a balance here between making sure that he gets the message that his conduct is unacceptable, but not being punitive so that he can then turn the story back to him and make himself a victim and use her, you know, actions as a basis to suggest that she can't be partial, impartial in his case.
I guess so, except that he violated a gag order. That is a threat. Any way you slice it, that is a threat, putting it up with crosshairs. And so why wouldn't she send a message by throwing the book at him? I mean, he is a public figure. People can't do this. They need to tone it down on social media. So, you know, I mean, why wouldn't she be punitive in this case?
Well, I mean, she certainly is within her power to. I think some of this is, you know, Roger Stone is trying to be provocative here. He's trying to stay in the public attention, and I'm not sure she really wants to play into that. If I could just go back to the previous question, one of the reasons on Barr that he has so much authority here was because of the excesses of Ken Starr.
Correct.
They allowed the independent counsel statute in 1999 or 2000 to expire because, you know, 2,700 pages went up to and was made public. There is a middle ground, and Barr needs to find that, the middle ground of, I'm not going to release everything, but I have to release it. And in fact, politically, I don't think it's that big a winner for the president if this thing is kept secret, because then you still have 60% of the country who thinks he did it. There's going to be exculpatory things in here. There has to be. And I think that politically, it's not as simple equation as everyone thinks.
No, and there is a different precedent. There's a Jaworski precedent from 1974 where some of the grand jury testimony could be made available to Congress if they're engaged in impeachment proceedings, which is formality. But that could be something big to watch for in the House. All right, Asha, Joe, Laura, thank you very much.
All right, college basketball's brightest star stopped in his tracks.
New this morning, Pope Francis opening an historic Vatican summit on clergy abuse. The Pope telling senior church leaders to, quote, listen to the cry of the small who are asking for justice. Bishops from around the world are attending the four-day conference. The Pope says Catholics are not looking for mere condemnation, but concrete actions to confront the scandal of pedophilia.
President Trump refusing to allow an Alabama woman who traveled to Syria to join ISIS to return to the United States. The president says that he instructed Secretary of State Mike Pompeo to block Hoda Muthana from returning to the U.S. Muthana left America 5 years ago to join ISIS, and she recently made a public plea to come back and stand trial in America. Pompeo says Muthana, who is detained at the moment in a Kurdish refugee camp, is not an American citizen. Her citizenship is now in dispute.
A huge scare for Duke basketball fans.
I hate when your soul comes loose.
Yes.
If you know what I mean.
I've been there.
Yeah, me too. All right. Is another a top Trump administration official on the way out? We'll tell you who may be getting the boot soon. Get it?
Boot? The shoe? I knew you did there. Just moments ago, Empire actor Jussie Smollett, we learned, is now under arrest and in the custody of detectives in Chicago. He's facing a felony charge for allegedly filing a false report. Police, he claimed the two men attacked him last month. Let me read you the statement. Actor Jussie briefing later this morning at 10 a.m. Eastern Time. A bail hearing is set for this afternoon.
Just remarkable how this story has turned around. All right, now to this. President Trump says the Director of National Intelligence, Dan Coats' job is safe. But sources tell CNN that there are preliminary discussions in the White House about replacing him. We're back with Lisa Monaco. Lisa, this is troubling because this is not just the president souring on someone on his staff, as he sometimes does. This isn't just the president getting rid of somebody in a fit of pique. This is because he does not like hearing that ISIS and North Korea are still threats. That is different than the president's narrative. And of course, the Director of National Intelligence, that's his job, to give the national intelligence. So here are examples of how the president would like to spin it versus what DNI Coats has said. Watch this.
We have won against ISIS. We've beaten them, and we've beaten them badly.
ISIS is intent on resurging and still commands thousands of fighters in Iraq and Syria.
Kim, we have a great chemistry. And we're well on our way. You know, we signed an agreement It said, we will begin the immediate denuclearization.
North Korea will seek to retain its WMD capabilities and is unlikely to completely give up its nuclear weapons and production capabilities.
Lisa, if they get rid of DNI codes, what does that tell you?
Well, look, Allison, if the reporting is true and they get rid of DNI Coates because he has given his unvarnished intelligence assessments based on the work of career professionals who serve without fear or favor across the political spectrum, that is another blow to the intelligence community, which frankly has had to endure a daily pummeling from the president, who seems to agree with Vladimir Putin's assessments instead of his own intelligence community. The other thing is, you know, people need to remember DNI Coates and others who serve in political as well as in career positions take an oath to the Constitution and to the country. They do not take an oath to any individual president. And DNI Coates' job is national security and unvarnished intelligence assessments, not policy.
Former Secretary of State Madeleine Albright, who was no fan of the President of the United States at this point, told me, I worked for presidents who actually wanted to know what was going on. What is the impact of this, Lisa, even having this discussion a week before the president is scheduled to meet with North Korean leader Kim Jong-un?
Well, what it does, John, is it sends another signal of chaos in the administration, and it sends a very bad signal, of course, to the intelligence community. You know, when I served as the president's Homeland Security and Counterterrorism Advisor, I spent every morning in the president's daily brief, the morning intelligence briefing, with the DNI, as well as the rest of the national security team. And oftentimes, the president would get uncomfortable assessments, meaning assessments that weren't great for policy decisions. But presidents should want to hear the whole truth and nothing but the truth.
Right. And it means that for the American public, they will only be able to get the truth from our Clarissa Ward and Arwa Damon and Nick Payton Walsh, who are on the ground and bring us stories, thank goodness, of what's happening where in places, in pockets where ISIS is still trying to be victorious. And so, I mean, if they get rid of DNI Coates and find somebody who is more in line with the president's thinking that everything is rosy, what does that do for the country?
Well, it's very dangerous, Allison, because what it does is it only gives one perspective or one vantage point. As good as reporting can be, it's not everything, right? Hopefully, the intelligence community has a lot more information than can be acquired in the public realm. And it's all of that information that needs to be compiled and put before policymakers, including the chief policymaker, the president, so he and the rest of the team can make informed judgments. And without that full spectrum of analysis, it's going to make things more dangerous and really hurt our ability to make those good decisions.
Lisa Monaco, thanks for sticking around and helping us understand this. We're watching this also very, very closely. New this morning, a CNN exclusive. Senior Iraqi intelligence sources tell CNN they may be close to capturing the elusive ISIS leader Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi. But al-Baghdadi has slipped through their fingers before. CNN's Arwa Damon on this story in Erbil, in Iraq, with this exclusive reporting. Arwa, what have you learned?
Good morning, John. Well, in trying to track some of al-Baghdadi's locations, we've managed to get some insight into how it is, at least up until now, he has been able to so successfully go to ground.
Reverberating through the streets of the old city during this Friday sermon are words about the true meaning of freedom in Islam. But it was also on a Friday in July of 2014 when Mahmoud Dawood, an imam, says his cell phone suddenly lost reception. I saw masked men all over the neighborhood and on rooftops, he tells us. The cars came. It's the first time I see them, more than 200 with tinted windows. And then Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi showed up, declared the caliphate, himself its leader, and ordered all Muslims to obey him.
And that's exactly where al-Baghdadi gave his address.
Mahmoud says he knew in that moment that Iraq would be demolished. It's the only one of al-Baghdadi's locations that is fully confirmed. Since then, despite being hunted by the best intelligence agencies, there has been little more than brief sightings, spotty intelligence, and conflicting information. Saddam al-Jamal, a mid-level Syrian ISIS prisoner on death row in the Iraqi capital, says he never saw al-Baghdadi, but was close to those who did. About a year and a half ago, he tells us, there were attempts by foreign fighters to overthrow Baghdadi, but he had them all killed. The dissent within ISIS leadership ranks has even further shrunk the entourage around Baghdadi. The sprawling town of Shirgat is one of the areas where an intelligence source says Baghdadi moved through in 2015, holding meetings with senior commanders in safe houses.
We've been talking to residents here, none of whom will appear on camera, but they were telling us that they saw ISIS's top military commander coming in and out of this house. And numerous sources say that this is where he was killed in 2015. And an Iraqi intelligence source tells us that this house is one of the places where he would meet with Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi.
There were also reports that we cannot confirm that Baghdadi was wounded in that same airstrike. A senior Iraqi intelligence officer says that on at least three occasions, two in Iraq and one in Syria, they called in strikes that came close to taking him out. For insight into how the ISIS leader may be moving around, we head from Shirgat to the edge of Baghdadi's former hideout, the foothills of the Himreen Mountains. To the west of here lies a vast stretch of desert that leads into Syria. Exclusive images obtained by CNN show what we are told are ISIS spotter hideouts masquerading as nomad tents. Photographs of the tunnels inside the mountains.
Image of these gorges that exist throughout this entire area. And in fact, at one point, they were actually able to, while moving through these gorges, come up and attempt to plant an IED right here on the road.
Out here, ISIS still rules the night, coming down in small groups to murder, plant bombs, and steal. The Iraqis believe they are closing in on Baghdadi, but he has eluded them more than once, disappearing into the shadows of these lawless lands.
You know, seeing the terrain and the landscape there are so important. What would the capture of al-Baghdadi actually do to the strength of ISIS?
Well, it really depends. They may struggle to try to find a leader who is potentially going to be as charismatic. And there are all sorts of divisions that do exist within ISIS, John, especially at the leadership level. But then there is also the fact that, at least according to one Iraqi analyst we spoke to who has been studying ISIS for years now, that the networks that exist in Syria and Iraq, even though they are the best known and most notorious, perhaps, ISIS has planned for this. ISIS has networks in North Africa, in Europe, and in Southeast Asia, and they operate independently. They're called the foreign or outside bureaus. ISIS also has this very vast financial infrastructure. And these other networks and the cells that exist that ISIS still has right now, they operate on their own, so they don't necessarily even need al-Baghdadi to be able to function.
Arwa, we would not be able to understand this as well without your reporting. Thank you so much for bringing us the reporting and all of the video and showing us what it really looks like on the ground. All right, we are following breaking news for you this morning. Empire actor Jussie Smollett is now under arrest. He is facing a felony charge for allegedly filing a false police report. We have all of the breaking details for you next.